Now, next week, according to President Biden's order, we're supposed to have a release of records. The agencies are supposed to release records unless they have requested further postponements. It's our understanding that both the CIA and the FBI have continued to request postponements. We will find out next week what President Biden's decision is. But the question is, why are they still trying to hide records 60 years later? And what are the records that they don't want to disclose? What do those records show? What are they trying to hide? And that's what the purpose of this conference will be today. We have some really excellent speakers. Our first speaker is going to be Rex Bradford, who is the president of the Mary Farrell Foundation. They were the plaintiffs in a lawsuit that we'll talk about later. Rex is also the designer of that wonderful search engine on the Mary Farrell website, which is usually the place to go for researchers and historians. Then we're going to be followed by Judge Tunheim, who is a district court judge for the District of Minnesota. He just finished his term as chief judge of the district. Judge Tunheim was chair of the Assassination Records Review Board, which did a remarkable job getting together about 4 million assassination records. They scoured the federal government for records and decided which ones could be disclosed immediately or which ones could be postponed. And he will speak about his experience with the ARB and with the bureaucracy. And then the next speaker will be Jeff Morley, who has written many books, including Our Man in Mexico, a book about James Angleton, and his most recent book, Scorpion, which is about Watergate and related issues. Jeff is going to talk about records that are being withheld and what he thinks they show. And then finally, Fernand Amande works for a polling and public research firm, and he's going to disclose the results of an interesting poll that he conducted recently. Now, for some housekeeping tips. First of all, for those in the room, please keep your phones on mute or turn them down. We're going to have questions at the end of the presentations. And for those of you that are watching from YouTube, if you want to post a question, you can send me a text. My phone number is 917-576-3667, and we'll try to get to those at the end. So without any further delay, Rex, would you like to start?
Thanks, Larry. Good morning. My name is Rex Bradford. I'm president of the nonprofit Mary Farrell Foundation. Our organization runs a website at maryfarrell.org, which contains about 2 million pages of declassified records on the Kennedy assassination and other related topics, along with search tools to try to make those documents accessible. In October, our foundation, along with two individual citizens, filed suit in federal court seeking enforcement of the JFK Records Act. I want to talk for a few minutes this morning about why we filed the suit and then hand off to our distinguished panelists. President Kennedy was killed almost 60 years ago, and the excessive secrecy began immediately with the declaration of Earl Warren that there were some things that might not be revealed even in your lifetime. Later, after Watergate and the revelations of U.S. plots to assassinate Fidel Castro and other foreign leaders, there was hope that a congressional reinvestigation would pierce the veil. Instead, that body issued a report, and then its files went into the vaults of the National Archives. The American people eventually said enough. The result was the 1992 JFK Records Collection Act, which begins with the declaration that, quote, all government records related to the assassination of President John F. Kennedy should carry a presumption of immediate disclosure, and all records should be eventually disclosed to enable the public to become fully informed about the history surrounding the assassination. The JFK Act created the Assassination Records Review Board to oversee the process. I'm very happy that Judge Tunheim, who chaired that board, is with us today. The 1990s saw the declassification of literally millions of pages of formerly secret files. Now, the work of the review board may not have produced a new headline for the perennial question, who killed JFK, but its revelations and impact was nonetheless profound. The story of the formation of the Warren Commission, born out of a desire to head off World War III, can now be heard in Lyndon Johnson's own recorded voice. The strange saga of accused assassin Lee Harvey Oswald's trip to Mexico City, visiting Cuban and Soviet embassies there, allegations arising from which drove the communist conspiracy line, which was driving LBJ and the Warren Commission behind closed doors, finally reached the public 30 years later. And because of the broad mandate of the act, we even learned things we didn't know about formerly secret Kennedy foreign policy, particularly on Cuba and Vietnam. Because of the JFK Records Act, the unknowable question, what would Kennedy have done in Vietnam, now sits uncomfortably alongside the certainty that at the moment of his death, it was U.S. policy to fully withdraw. And bit by bit, we've continued to learn more about the troubling topic of the CIA's interest in Lee Harvey Oswald prior to the assassination. The Warren Commission's depiction of an unknown loner doesn't square easily with one senior CIA's officer assertion that, quote, the effect was electric when Oswald's name came over the wire on the afternoon of 11/22/63. Nor does it sit well with another officer's admission that the strange handling of Oswald's file indicated a keen interest in Oswald held very closely on the need-to-know basis. My colleague Jeff Morley will be presenting new information on this very important story today. So we've been peeling layers off the onion that is the murder of a U.S. president at the height of the Cold War, year by year. But the work remains unfinished. The JFK Act specified a precise time frame for when all JFK records would be released in full, 25 years from passage. That was October of 2017. Three times since then, some documents have been released and the can been kicked down the road on others. The public deserves what Congress intended when it wrote the law 30 years ago, full disclosure, and that's what we're seeking in court. We've also identified a few particular document sets which do not specifically reside in the collection, absent due to time constraints on the review board, but clearly meeting the definition of assassination record as defined by the Act. And we're asking that these also be released. Jeff Morley's presentation will highlight one of these. Now, overclassification is hardly limited to the JFK assassination, of course, although this topic has perhaps at times been the poster child. The JFK Records Act and the Freedom of Information Act, which came before it, are tools born of the recognition that this is a government by the people, of the people, and ultimately its records are our history. The Mary Ferrell Foundation's mission is to make the formerly secret history accessible. We have for over 15 years been digitizing many of these records and putting them online behind a search engine. And we've done other projects, for instance, taking the National Archives Master Index of the JFK collection, which in 2022 is an Excel spreadsheet, and built an interactive research tool in front of it. We then use this tool to study the data in this critical finding aid for locating documents, and we found major gaps and inconsistencies, something we're also asking be corrected in the lawsuit. As an example, more than 1,000 of the documents released by the archives in 2017 and 2018 simply do not appear in the so-called master index. Our foundation strives to provide access and to bring these paper records to life. The stories in them remain all too relevant for studying how a government functions when in crisis. Ideally, this shouldn't have to be a private organization's job. The National Archives has recently announced that it has digitized 200 million pages of records. Well, how about the JFK collection, one of its most popular sought-after paper? President Biden, a year ago, asked the archives for a plan to do so, and as yet, all we have is still just a plan. In any case, at minimum, the National Archives is legally charged with completing the work of the review board, fulfilling the JFK Records Act, and finally ending the secrecy. It is not without irony that blanket national security claims are being invoked to withhold documents considering a matter which is a murder which is said to have been committed by a single lone malcontent. And there has been a real cost to the lack of transparency and the incessant disclosure delays. Persons named in the documents have died and can no longer be interviewed. Sometimes when declassification is finally mandated, it turns out the documents have gone missing, as the review board discovered happened with a great many deposition transcripts of the 1970s Church Committee. It's been said that the government's records may only offer an oblique path to the truth in this matter, but in the end, they're the best we've got. It's time to stop kicking this can down the road. Thank you for coming today. I'd like to turn things back down to Laird and introduce Judge Tunheim.
Okay, thank you. So our next speaker is Judge Tunheim, who was the chair of the Assassination Records Review Board. You cannot understate the amount of work that this board did. They had 4 million, with a small staff, they ended up having 4 million records sent into a collection with great obstruction from many of the agencies. And their final report from September 1998 is an enormously important historic document about the way the government, the process of declassification. It's a really important document, which today is even still relevant. So with that, I'll introduce Judge Tunheim.
Thank you, Larry. I'm very happy to be here today. As Larry said, I had the honor of serving as the chairman of the Assassination Records Review Board. We were a professional group. We were appointed by President Clinton, confirmed by the Senate to do this work, which we completed in a four-year time period. The four other members of the board, historians and an archivist, have all passed away, and so I'm the remaining person. We had a professional staff of about 30, and worked hard for 4 years to find as much as we possibly could and release as much as we possibly could. I've now served for just about 27 years as a federal district court judge in Minnesota, a part of that time overlapping with my last 2.5 years on the review board. So I want to just talk a little bit about the challenge right now today. We did work very hard 25 years ago to fulfill the purpose of the President John F. Kennedy Records Collection Act of 1992, and that goal was to secure the public release of all records related to the assassination, and in so doing, to assure America and the world that the federal government was not withholding material information about the horribly tragic event. The Congress stated that all records related to the assassination would carry a presumption of immediate disclosure. I remind you, this was 30 years ago when Congress made this statement, a presumption of immediate disclosure. At that time, most of these records were 30 years old or more, and Congress stipulated that only in the rarest of cases is there any legitimate need for continued protection. Again, this was 30 years ago when Congress made this statement. The review board anticipated, as Congress mandated, that the small amount of postponed information, no documents, we protected no documents, we protected some information within documents, would be open to the public no later than 2017, 25 years after the passage of the act, which is what the act stipulated. And in 2017, as Larry said, the can was kicked down the road a little bit further by President Trump, and now we're still waiting today for the final disclosure. So the president now has this non-delegable power to decide to release the remaining redacted information, and I've been encouraging the full release of everything that is remaining redacted in these files. This would be an important move for transparency and finality to the ordeal, and the information, what we redacted, I've largely seen. It doesn't contain bombshells of any kind, but it is important to be able to tell the American people that everything has been released. Nothing is being hidden from them, and they have access to the federal government's entire record of the assassination. That, in my view, would be a great service to providing full transparency and the truth about the event, which even today, of course, remains mired in controversy and conspiracy beliefs. So we did order the release of over 50,000 documents for which federal agencies sought postponement. Well over half of the documents were released when the agencies realized that their arguments would not satisfy the board. The law required that the agencies prove by clear and convincing evidence, which is a high standard, clear and convincing evidence that the need to protect the information outweighed the public interest in the information. And of course, in our view, and I think the view of everyone, is that all information related to the assassination of an American president carries an incredible interest level, which was factored into our decisions. The board had the authority to declassify the information, and if an agency objected, the agency had the right to appeal the board's decision directly to the president. The same high standard applies in the act today. The review board doesn't exist anymore, but the standards remain the same. President Clinton never reversed a review board decision to declassify information related to the assassination, despite many appeals made. And as stated, over 4 million pages in 1998 were publicly available at the National Archives, very few with minimal redactions. So let me address a couple of arguments I think that are being made today by the agencies to the president. The issue of informants, protecting the identity and location of informants. This was a key issue that the board grappled with throughout our 4 years. The need to provide some level of protection to informants, both intelligence informants and law enforcement informants. I will say that in order to fully evaluate the information in files, you need to know where it came from, and that's an important part of the records. If you're going to evaluate the truthfulness and the importance of information, you need to know who provided that information to, say, the CIA or the FBI. So the board provided detailed guidance to the agencies on how to address the problem of informants and the protection that they deserve. We required the agency to prove two things to us. One, evidence that the informant was still living. And secondly, the likelihood that they would be harmed upon disclosure of their name. A general argument that all informants, including foreigners, must be protected was clearly rejected by the board. We made that clear. It's in our final report in the chapter five, which lists the guidance that we provided on a lot of difficult subjects for the agencies. In most cases, I will tell you, the agency could not comply with our requirements, and the names were released. Even when agencies could comply, the board estimated a future date beyond which we thought the individual would no longer be living. Many of these individuals are informants from the 1960s and earlier. We attached that date to the redaction, and then after that date, the National Archives was authorized to release the name. All those dates have now passed, and those names have been released. And to my knowledge, no one has been harmed as a result of public disclosure of names. Embarrassed, maybe. Maybe families have been embarrassed, but that's not the standard. The standard is whether the individual could be harmed and we're still living. I think this issue probably is still before the president. This is a common refrain from the agencies about the need to protect their informants. But I remind everyone, this was 60 years ago or more. I want to point out one other area, and I think that Jeff is going to talk a little bit more about the saga of George Ioannidis. When he talks about it, you should know that the board had this file at one point in time, and we were told that he was simply the liaison between the CIA and the House Select Committee on Assassinations and provided no central role at all. That turned out not to be true, and that file should be released in full. We would have released it had we been told accurate information by the CIA. And let me mention one other topic, too. An example of documents, a series of documents with redactions that should be released in full, involves a postponement the board approved based on an argument by the State Department that if disclosed evidence of a country's president's cooperation with the CIA would bring that government down. Today, that political power party is no longer in control, hasn't been for a long time, and so there's little risk of a government going down because of the release of that information. So there, the precise reason for postponement no longer exists. So the board would not accept any generalized arguments that national security would be impacted, that intelligence gathering methods would be disclosed, or that presidential protection methods would be compromised. We've required specific information which would disclose such serious impacts, and in nearly all cases, agencies were unable to provide such specific impact, and the documents were released without any problems. I want to point out one other area where the board ultimately was unsuccessful. We probably didn't have enough time to get this done. And we tried hard at Congress's direction to obtain the release of KGB records, notably the KGB file on Lee Harvey Oswald, which resides, the originals reside in Minsk in Belarus. We had negotiated a plan to provide copies of those files for the National Archives, but senior government authorities in Minsk ultimately vetoed the deal. We received little help from the Department of State, despite the law's clear direction for the department to assist us in this regard. It's my hope that these files can be obtained at some point in the future. They're very valuable. There's a lot of them. They stand about 5 feet tall. If you looked at the stack, many specific instances were read to me, and they're very interesting, and they should be released because anything related to Mr. Oswald is relevant and important for researchers. I want to mention one other situation that has always bothered me, and that involves the situation that involved a close aide to Attorney General Robert Kennedy. Actually, he was a close aide to Robert Kennedy for many years in various roles. His name was Walter Sheridan. Sheridan was said to have done private investigations for Robert Kennedy. His files had been deposited at the Kennedy Library. Just before we took office, he went to the library and retrieved those files, taking them away from the library. And he died not long thereafter. We worked together with his surviving spouse to see if he had any additional files in his home. He did not. It turned out the files were deposited at NBC. Mr. Sheridan had provided work on a white paper that was done in 1967 during the prosecution of Clay Shaw, and therefore NBC asserted a privilege over his entire files. This is in contrast to CBS, who worked closely with us to make available all of the video that they had shot over the years in all of their various programs and investigations into the assassination. But Sheridan's files, to my knowledge, still remain hidden at NBC, and that should be released. There's no reason for that. It might clear up some of the questions about what Sheridan was doing in the days after the assassination. Be glad to answer questions. The bottom line is that I think that it's time to release all of the files. There may be some hiccups in the agencies about releasing files, but these same sorts of things happened 30 years ago. I will say that the board did not protect anything that we felt was centrally related to the assassination. Regardless of the standards, if it was an important point to understanding the assassination, we did not release it. Or we did not protect it, I should say. We released everything that we felt was very important for the public to know. The redactions are a little bit more of a sideshow, but I think in the interests of transparency and honesty, everything should be released so that we can say that nothing is being hidden anymore. Thank you.
I'm now going to briefly talk about both the lawsuit and the efforts that a group of attorneys and private researchers have been doing the last year and a half to try to get the records that are still being held back released. The research community was kind of stunned when President Trump postponed the records because he had said orally that he was going to release them. Query whether the fact that he thought that he would release them meant that they were declassified, but that's a story for another day. So no action was taken after the President Trump postponed the records. And we organized a group of lawyers beginning of January of 2021. We met every Friday for a year, going over the JFK Records Act, going over, you know, all the stuff that was done. I actually filed a FOIA lawsuit against the National Archives to get the underlying correspondence for the decisions that led to the Donald Trump's two postponements. And I have, there were some really interesting disclosures from that. I have two memos here dated August 21st, 2017, both from William Bosanco, who's the chief operating officer of the National Archives, to the CIA and the FBI, where the National Archives is objecting to the grounds that the FBI and the CIA were using to postpone the records. Unfortunately, the only public record that's available is a record from the archivist to the president in September of 2017 and March of 2018 recommending further postponement and that this postponement complied with the act. That memo was written by the National Security Council. I have the email showing that. They went through 12 different drafts. And it shows that the National Archives, even though they objected to the grounds, as a bureaucrat was forced to fall on its sword and go through this orchestrated dance of requesting the president to postpone the records. That was one of the things we discovered. We also asked the Oversight Committee of the House to hold an oversight hearing on the failure of the president, the executive branch, to comply with the JFK Records Act. We got a response in September or August of this year, and unfortunately, allegedly because of the schedule in the midterms, there was no time for a hearing. We suspect that there was no interest in having a hearing that could potentially embarrass the sitting president, Democratic president, with a Democratic House before the midterms. So we're going to continue to push that next year. We sent a letter to the president, President Biden, in August of 2021, urging him to release the records. We had it signed by historians, writers, lawyers, and researchers. And we actually put together a brief explaining how President Trump's postponements of the records did not comply with the JFK Records Act. What he did was, unlike the statutory language, it says that in order to certify postponement, the president must make on a document-by-document basis an explanation identifying in an unclassified way what the identifiable harm is that's posed by this document and how it outweighs the public interest in the document. And as Judge Tunheim said, there's a presumption of disclosure. President Trump did not do that. It was just a blanket sweeping assertion that the 15,000 documents posed a risk to national security and did not explain what that risk was for each document. Did that twice. So then we told President Biden, this is how the President Trump had misconstrued the law. But unfortunately, President Biden decided to postpone the release of the records one more year. And instead of using the statutory term identified harm, he indicated to the agencies that they could postpone records if they identified anticipated harm, which is not the same as identified harm. So under his memo, the agencies were supposed to notify the National Archives by September 1st of this year if they were going to object to any further releases of records. If they could not reach agreement with the National Archives by October 1st, the agencies were then to elevate it to the president or withdraw their objection. We understand from sources within NARA that the CIA and the FBI continue to object to releases of some of the documents. And so right now, as we're meeting, decisions are being made in the White House as to what documents are going to be released or not. Of the memo that I had seen in 2017, the FBI had roughly 7,400 files that were withheld, either in full or completely, and 6,000 of those files related to the mafia. So why are they holding back records about the mafia? So in October, the lawyers then, Bill Simpich and I, Bill Simpich is lead counsel, I'm co-counsel, filed a lawsuit in the Northern District of California, suing the president and National Archives. We are alleging that the president, first of all, failed to comply with the JFK Records Act in his postponement of October 2021, when he first used the pandemic as a reason. Number one, that's not a statutory ground. And number two, used the wrong standard, identifiable. He's anticipated harm rather than identifiable harm. Number two, while the ARB went out of business in 1998, its work was not done. Congress, I don't think, appreciated the extent of the work that had to be done. And when the ARB went out of business, they still had outstanding search requests to a number of agencies. And as far as we can tell, the National Archives, who is the successor to the ARB in terms of processing records, has not followed up on those outstanding record requests. So we have, in our complaint, asked the judge to order the National Archives to complete those outstanding record searches. Now, the record searches are not only to government agencies. They were to the Robert F. Kennedy Trust, Family Trust. Robert F. Kennedy had his own Mar-a-Lago event. Right an hour after the president was killed, Robert Kennedy seized the records in the Oval Office, took them, and eventually they were deposited in the JFK Library. We believe those records probably involve Cuba, maybe some embarrassing stuff, but they're still being withheld. And as you can see, NBC is holding back records that the ARP said were assassination records. In 2017, we had a mock trial in Houston, South Texas College of Law, and our two-day mock trial. And the night after the first day of the mock trial, Alec Baldwin was our guest speaker at a dinner. And Alec Baldwin had shared with us that when he had a program on NBC in 2013, he was going to have a 50th anniversary program on the assassination. The last minute, he had lined up all these great speakers. The last minute, the episode was killed. And so he asked the senior producer, why is the episode being killed? He says, and the producer said, it's the policy of the NBC network to support the Warren Commission. So we're not only facing opposition and resistance in the government, the media is complicit in some elements to this continuing to hold back records. So we also have information that there are records still that were withheld from the ARB that are still out there that are not part of the JFK collection. Remember, one of the purposes of the act was to take all these records that were located all across the government. The ARB would assemble them, and they would be transmitted to the JFK collection, and then the ARB would decide which records could be disclosed. We think we have information that there are still records out there that are not part of the collection. In other words, they should be part of the collection. So we're asking the court also to order NARA to do another search for these outstanding records. So that's the basis for the lawsuit. We have a meeting with the judge in January, And stay tuned to see what happens. We'll see what happens. So even if next week, if President Biden releases all the records, we still have two other counts that we're going to want in this lawsuit the judge to give some relief. So the lawsuit will not go away if all the records are released next week. With that, Jeff.
Thank you, Larry. Thanks to the other speakers. Can we get the monitor? So greetings to all the people who are watching the live stream and in the room. We've heard a very comprehensive presentation about the JFK Records Act, what it's intended to do, the efforts to see that it's fully fulfilled. I want to talk about the records that we don't have yet. The question that we get most often at the Mary Ferrell Foundation these days is, what are they hiding? What could they possibly be hiding after 59 years? This was what NBC News asked when we filed our lawsuit. And I'm here to give an answer. In our lawsuit, we identify, there's a section, we identify 10 cases of improperly withheld material. And this is one of those. So this is not the only case of missing records that the Mary Ferrell Foundation is seeking to obtain, but it is a representative sample. What the CIA is hiding is what they've always hidden, which is their sources and methods as relate to Lee Harvey Oswald. By sources and methods, I mean spy techniques, infiltration, deception, psychological warfare, wiretapping, and the like. That's been the story since 1963. But we can answer that question, what are they hiding, with more specificity now. And this is the result of a lot of work by me and other researchers associated with the Mary Ferrell Foundation. What the CIA is hiding is a covert operation that involved Lee Harvey Oswald, used him for intelligence purposes in the summer of 1963, 3 months before President Kennedy was killed. This is an extraordinarily serious claim, and it has profound implications for the official story. The CIA knew far more about the lone gunman than they are admitting even today. So this story deserves the closest possible scrutiny. That's why the Mary Ferrell Foundation is bringing it to the attention of the press and the public. To understand this very complex story, it's important to understand three key JFK developments that have happened since the 1990s, information that was developed or found by the review board, and what we have learned. This is information that was not available to the Warren Commission and has not been widely reported in the media, but there's little dispute that these are true. The first is the complete declassification of the CIA's file on Lee Harvey Oswald. That did not take place until 2001. It only took 38 years. But when that was done, we had a whole new understanding of what the CIA knew about Oswald before the assassination. According to the official story, the CIA didn't know much. Deputy Director Richard Helms told the Warren Commission that the CIA's information about Oswald before November 22nd was, and I quote, probably minimal. The declassification of the file showed that Helms' testimony was definitely false. In fact, CIA counterintelligence chief James Angleton had opened a file on Oswald when he defected to the Soviet Union in November 1959 as a 20-year-old ex-Marine. Angleton's minions then monitored this allegedly unimportant character as he made his way from Moscow to Minsk to Fort Worth to New Orleans to Mexico City and finally to Dallas. A handful of top CIA officers all knew about Oswald's travels, his politics, and his personal life while JFK was alive. In fact, they had even read his mail. A second key point that we've learned since the 1990s concerns the use of deception operations in 1963. These were unknown to the Warren Commission and are now established fact. Perhaps the most notorious of these was COINTELPRO, the counterintelligence program, which was a joint CIA-FBI program to harass and disrupt leftist groups that U.S. policymakers considered an obstacle to their goals. Another was Operation Northwoods, discovered by Judge Tunheim and the Review Board in 1997. This was a Pentagon scheme to provoke a war with Cuba by staging a spectacular act of violence in the United States and using trusted covert personnel, CIA officers, to arrange for the blame to fall on Fidel Castro, thus giving the president authority to invade Cuba, a policy that the generals favored all along. And the third most important, third key development since the 1990s is that the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, an organization to which Oswald belonged, had been targeted by the CIA for disruption and destruction in the fall of 1963. All of these components come to play in the story of the undisclosed Oswald operation. The pre-assassination Oswald file is kind of the foundation of this story that I'm going to tell you. The undisclosed operation did not involve a conspiracy to kill the president, at least as far as the available evidence shows. Rather, the operation seems to have been a COINTELPRO-style operation against the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. We don't know yet who approved this operation, but we do know that its impact was felt massively on the evening of November 22, 1963. Earlier that day, President Kennedy and First Lady Jackie Kennedy traveled to Texas for a political trip. As the presidential motorcade passed by a friendly crowd in downtown Dallas, gunfire erupted. Kennedy was struck in the back and the head. He was taken to a nearby hospital where he died 30 minutes later. The country and the world had barely absorbed that shocking news when Dallas police announced that a suspect had been arrested. His name was Lee Harvey Oswald. Kennedy was killed by a communist, a supporter of Fidel Castro, a leader of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. CBS News anchor Walter Cronkite had the story. Oh, let's get the sound up here.
This is Walter Cronkite with the CBS Evening News. John Fitzgerald Kennedy was assassinated today in the 46th year of his life and his third year as President of the United States. Oswald, as we said, was local chairman of the pro-Castro Fair Play for Cuba Committee. He went to Russia in 1959 saying he was relinquishing his United States citizenship. He returned last year complaining that he was disillusioned. Whether or not he ever actually did get Soviet citizenship is not clear, but he did marry while in Russia and is said to have one or two children. His wife is in this country with him and was taken to the police station this afternoon also. Oswald worked in the building where the murder weapon, a German-made Mauser rifle, was discovered. Oswald has been active in propaganda activities, as Bob Jones from station WWL-TV in New Orleans reports.
This is Lee H. Oswald, October 16th in New Orleans, when he was handing out handbills for the Fair Play for Cuba Committee in front of the International Trademark. New Orleans police know Oswald well. On August 9th, he was arrested for disturbing the peace by creating a scene on the city's main Canal Street by also distributing these handbills. He resided in an apartment here from May 9th until August 20th, when he slipped out in the middle of the night without having paid his rent. The apartment manager said he was quiet and talked to no one. They found several of these pamphlets lying around the apartment after he had left. This is Bob Jones, WWL-TV.
So far, Lee Oswald has only been accused of killing a Dallas policeman. As far as the assassination is concerned, he is described only as a prime suspect. He has denied any knowledge of the assassination of the president. Although he once actually turned in his American passport in Moscow, it's not known whether he actually became a Russian citizen. His wife is known to be Russian-born. They most recently lived in a rooming house in Dallas. Again, he was arrested in New Orleans last August after he got into a fight while distributing material for
for the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. Here is the interview he gave at that time to station WDSU-TV in New Orleans.
No, sir, I am not a communist, and I think that the red herring and so forth is rather ridiculous to toss into this conversation.
Then are you a Marxist?
Well, I have studied Marxist philosophy, yes, sir, and also other philosophers.
But are you a Marxist? I think you did admit on an earlier radio interview that you consider yourself a Marxist.
Well, I would very definitely say that I am a Marxist. That is correct. But that does not mean, however, that I'm a communist.
What is the difference between the two?
Well, there's a great deal of difference. Several American parties in several countries are based on Marxism, such as Ghana. Certain countries have characteristics of a socialist system, such as Great Britain with its socialized medicine. These, then, are the differences between an outright communist country and countries which adhere to leftist or Marxist principles.
In your work with the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, what are you advocating?
We advocate restoration of diplomatic, trade, and tourist relations with Cuba.
Oswald, for his part, at the same time, a spokesman for the anti-Castro Cuban Student Directorate was calling reporters all across the country in the national news media. This group was funded by the CIA. The spokesman told dozens of leading news reporters that the organization knew all about the man who killed Kennedy and his ties to the pro-Castro Fair Play for Cuba Committee. For his part, Oswald, now in Dallas police custody, hours after the assassination, emphatically denied killing the president.
I'd like some legal representation. These police officers have not allowed me to have any. I don't know what this is all about.
Did you shoot the president?
I work in that building.
Were you in the building at the time?
Naturally, if I work in that building, yes, sir.
Back up, man.
Did you shoot the president?
No, they're taking me in because of the fact that I live in the Soviet Union. I'm just a patsy.
Did you shoot the president?
Oswald said he was a patsy. And the next day, he was shot dead by Jack Rubio, owner of a Dallas nightclub with organized crime connections. The hidden hand of the CIA, we now know, shaped this media coverage of Kennedy's assassination and public understanding with covert activities that are still shrouded in official secrecy today. These activities began 11 months before, in January 1963. At the time, Cuba was a burning issue in American politics. JFK was rhetorically committed to overthrowing the communist government of Cuba, but Cuba was not a priority for him. His dovish policy privately angered the generals of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the CIA men in Miami, and their Cuban allies. On orders from President Kennedy, Deputy Director Helms sought to rein in one of the anti-Castro groups most harshly critical of the president, the Cuban Student Directorate. Led by daring students from Cuba's leading universities, the Directorio Revolucionario Estudiantil, DRE, had a knack for generating headlines that made Kennedy look weak or naive on the Cuba issue. The group was funded by the CIA under a program with the codename of AMSPEL. By mid-1963, the AMSPEL leaders in Miami were receiving $51,000 a month from the CIA, the equivalent of about $500,000 a month today. The money supported a network of delegations in North and South America. Helms sent George Ioannidis, an experienced officer from the Athens station, to handle the group. What is the CIA hiding? In late January 1963, five memos about Ioannidis' cover and his intelligence methods related to the AMSPEL program landed in his personnel file. All of these documents are still denied in full by the CIA. We believe these documents are important about the origins of the Oswald operation. The operation took shape when Ioannidis was granted a high-level security clearance in June 1963. This document you see here, partially declassified in 2004, shows that Ioannidis was cleared for special intelligence, the CIA's term of art for wiretapping. Why is that significant? Three reasons. The CIA was wiretapping Fair Play for Cuba Committee leaders at the time. Within 2 months, Ioannidis' network, the DRE AMSPEL network, would generate propaganda about Oswald and the Fair Play for Cuba Committee in New Orleans. And 3 months later, Oswald would arrive at the Mexico City consulate, the Cuban consulate in Mexico City, where his presence was picked up by a CIA wiretap. The operation was implemented in August 1963. Joannides played a supporting, not a leading role. On August 1st, he took over as the chief of the psychological warfare branch of the agency's Miami station. His main responsibility was guiding and monitoring the AMSPEL network. His assignment took him to New Orleans. In New Orleans, Oswald sought to attract attention to himself by calling himself the leader of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. He approached Carlos Bringer, the DRE AMSPEL delegate in New Orleans. He handed out FPC pamphlets near Bringer's store, which led to a fight with Bringer and three other DRE members. They were all arrested, and the New Orleans newspapers covered the arrest. When Oswald handed out FPC pamphlets a week later, he attracted the WDSU TV station. Bringer then arranged a debate with Oswald on the Cuba issue on the WDSU radio station. What a difference 30 days makes. Before Joannides took over as the AMSPEL case officer on August 1st, 1963, Lee Harvey Oswald had no public record as an activist on Cuba or a supporter of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. 30 days later, the FBI, the DRE AMSPEL, and WDSU possessed film footage, audio recordings, and newspaper coverage of Oswald, the Marxist leader of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. A legend had been created. This was standard procedure under COINTELPRO style operations. Use agents of influence, infiltrate the target organization, plant deceptive information, feed negative information to sympathetic news reporters, and use law enforcement to harass and arrest members of the target group. All of this happened when Oswald encountered AMSPEL in New Orleans in August 1963. Oswald went on to Mexico City within a month, where he went to the Cuban consulate seeking a visa to travel to Cuba. He showed his credentials and the evidence of his confrontation with the Cuban students in an effort to obtain the visa. The Cubans rejected the request, and Oswald returned to the United States. Meanwhile, his phone calls had been picked up by a CIA wiretap, by a special intelligence collection program. The Mexico City station sent a query to the Langley headquarters, who was Oswald. The question was routed to Angleton's staff. The lone gunman was not alone at this point. He was being observed and written about by top CIA officers. They replied by cable, telling the Mexico City Embassy they didn't know much about Oswald. They knew about, but didn't mention Oswald's arrest in New Orleans. The reason they didn't mention it was because it was an operation, and the Mexico City station had no need to know about it. That was October 10th, 1963.
Oswald, 42
days later, Kennedy went to Dallas,
Castro, Fair Play for Cuba,
and the operation in Mexico City came to fruition. The operation in New Orleans comes to fruition.
For the Fair Play for Cuba Committee in front of the International Trademark.
Again, he was arrested in New Orleans last August after he got into a fight while distributing material for the Fair Play for Cuba Committee.
Oswald has been active in propaganda activities.
All of the information about Oswald's pro-Castro politics that flooded the airwaves on November 22nd and the front pages of the newspapers, all of that information was generated by Oswald's encounter with the DRE AMSPEL network in New Orleans. The arrest, the TV appearance, the radio appearance, and the newspaper coverage. The CIA's secret campaign against the Fair Play for Cuba Committee succeeded. On December 28, 1963, the Fair Play for Cuba Committee disbanded. The Oswald episode was the fatal blow, said the New York Times. In other words, a CIA covert program, the DRE AMSPEL program, had taken actions that destroyed the leading group in the United States opposed to an aggressive U.S. policy against Cuba, and no one outside the CIA was any wiser. Joannides kept the Oswald AMSPEL operation secret. According to declassified records, he conducted security reviews on the agency's covert operations in 1963 while traveling to New Orleans in the spring of 1964. That's when the Warren Commission attorneys visited that city and investigated Oswald's antics with the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. What is the CIA hiding? There are 8 documents in Joe Ennedy's personnel file dated from April and May 1964. They are still denied in full because they concern Joe Ennedy's methods and his cover at that time. Deputy Director Helms kept the secret too. In his testimony to the Warren Commission, Helms insisted the CIA had no contact, direct or indirect, with Oswald. He did not mention that Oswald's anti-Castro antagonists, who linked him to the Fair Play for Cuba Committee both before and after the assassination, were under CIA funding and discipline. The Warren Commission report issued in September 1994 concluded Oswald acted alone and unaided. Joe Ennedy's moved on to covert assignments in Athens and Saigon before retiring in 1975. 1975 was the year that Congress reopened the JFK investigation. In the course of a decade, American politics had been transformed by the Vietnam War and the Watergate scandal. Thanks to revelations about domestic spying and assassination plots, the CIA faced congressional scrutiny for the first time in its 25 years of existence. When Congress extended the JFK investigation into 1978, George Ioannidis was called out of retirement to serve as liaison to the House Select Committee on Assassinations. HSCA counsel G. Robert Blakey on the left and staffer Dan Hardway on the right asked Ioannidis to identify the CIA officer who handled the Cuban Student Directorate in August 1963. They never imagined that the CIA lawyer they were talking to was the answer to their question. Ioannidis dissembled. He did not disclose what he knew about the contacts between the DRE AMSPEL agents and Oswald in 1963. In the lingo of the CIA, he protected the agency's sources and methods around Oswald. In the language of the law, Blakey and Hardway say Ioannidis obstructed their investigation, a felony. Ioannidis retired for a second time in January 1979. What is the CIA hiding? There are 7 classified memos in Ioannidis' personnel file from January 1979 concerning the intelligence methods and the cover that he used while dealing with the JFK investigators. All of them are denied in full, including a memo about why Ioannidis received a CIA memo after stonewalling the investigators. When the JFK Review Board asked the CIA about Ioannidis in 1998, the CIA responded deceptively, as Judge Tunheim mentioned before. What are they hiding? We can now answer that question with some precision. The CIA is hiding 44 documents known to exist in Ioannidis' personnel file that will shed light on his secret activities in 1963 and 1978. These include information about a CIA operation involving Lee Harvey Oswald that has never been disclosed. I'm not crazy about the term smoking gun. I think that's a bit of a cliche. It's not a term that investigative reporters use, but I think in this case it's appropriate. What we are talking about here is not smoking gun proof of a conspiracy to kill the president. We're talking about smoking gun proof of a CIA operation involving Lee Harvey Oswald that the CIA is still concealing in 2022. This body of records has profound implications for the official story of the assassination. Is the undisclosed Oswald operation evidence of CIA complicity in JFK's assassination? Is it evidence of incompetence in understanding the threat Oswald posed to the president? Only full disclosure on December 15th can resolve this question. The Ioannidis files constitute a clear and simple test for President Biden's order. Will these 44 records be released next week? The Mary Ferrell Foundation certainly hopes and expects that they will. We filed our lawsuit to complete the historical record of JFK's assassination as soon as possible. This story is just one example of why we took legal action. And now I want to I showed this presentation to Ralph Mowat Larson, who is a retired CIA officer, a friend of mine, who has written about the JFK assassination, lectured about the JFK assassination. He has spent 23 years in the CIA as a covert action officer. He was station chief in Moscow. He ran covert operations, counterintelligence investigations, and the like. There's no one really more qualified to comment on what I'm talking about here than Rolf. So let's hear what he had to say.
I'll start with a reaction that I had at the end, which is that to use the idea that sources and methods 60 years ago somehow still need to be protected from the greater imperative of knowing the truth, the facts, the truth, so we can make a judgment for ourselves as a people as to what happened. I think that it's incumbent on the U.S. government to make that case and not just assert, say, a privilege or a power that we gave the government to represent us. So that's my first reaction. My second is, you know, I'm very proud as a CIA officer who served for almost a quarter of a century in CIA of my service. I had the highest regard for the men and women of CIA then and now. However, with having said that, I'm very concerned and just disturbed by the kind of culture that would allow the agency to demonstrably cover up relevant factors all the way to today, relevant information for researchers, for people to understand, draw a conclusion themselves what happened on that day when the president was assassinated, the events that preceded it and followed it. And we're not able to do that without some sort of closure. Now, as I've looked at it, as hard as I can with the facts at hand, if there was a rogue conspiracy of a very small number of people involved in killing the president, essentially the CIA, the Warren Commission, the U.S. government were complicit in allowing that to be undiscovered by not being fully forthcoming over the years, and in some cases deceiving people who are trying to find the truth, whether it was the two commissions or other independent researchers over the years. So I think the three things I'll close with saying are at stake here in the release of this government are all in the category of principles. The first principle is the U.S. government, having demonstrably lied and deceived the American people from that event on of something of this importance in our history, can kind of regain a little bit of credibility. This is an opportunity for the CIA to come clean, not because the CIA was involved in Kennedy's assassination, but because the CIA understands that there is still a doubt as to what happened and whether there were people inside the CIA, defense, or any other parts of the U.S. government who might have been involved in this horrific conspiracy to kill the president. The second reason is that the idea of truth belonging to the American people is at stake here. And to lean back on what I said at the outset, where authorities and privileges of the government should only be done in extreme circumstances where the risk of disclosure of sources and methods puts something at risk. I think it's incumbent on the CIA at this point, the Biden administration, to specify exactly what's at risk in releasing sources and methods that were relevant 60 years ago. And to make my final point, because I think it's the most important, I want to quote Harry Truman in a December 22, 1963, Washington Post op-ed that he wrote. Harry Truman, of course, created CIA under his administration. And here's what he had to write exactly one month after the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Quote, "There is something about the way the CIA has been functioning that is casting a shadow over our historic position, and I feel we need to correct it." That's what's at stake here. That kind of credibility that the CIA can demonstrate to the American people. We have nothing to hide here. We're going to release these documents. We're going to look harder to see if there are documents that we should still release on behalf of the American people. And most importantly, for the reason of knowing what really happened to our president and playing a positive role instead of a deceptive role and a manipulative role, as the U.S. government did for too long after the assassination of the president. We're talking 60 years later, and we still don't know the full truth.
Do you think that the documents that I've described in the presentation are JFK related to the assassination? Do you think they should be released?
Jefferson, it's a very compelling presentation because you're a great researcher in the most important sense. You're independent. You're not trying to sell a conspiracy. You're not out to prove something that you know you can't prove. You're out to establish the basis to understand what happened. And so therefore, you know, the importance of that case study on the DRE and AMSPEL is that it's a lead, right? If this is a CIA rogue operation of some sort, your story is central to what happened. I'm not saying it is, but I'm saying it's a compelling enough case you made to examine the possibility and then dig deeper into if that were the case, who were the people involved? When George Johannidis refused, and therefore you have to say CIA refused also, to reveal, to divulge the names of the people running that operation to the House Assassination Select Committee, that is in essence a cover-up. That means we can't know that important truth of whether there's a connection between that activity of Oswald's in New Orleans and the assassination of the president, other people that may be involved with Oswald. Because I believe that if there was a CIA-looking kind of operation to kill the president, Oswald was involved, and Oswald was set up in that context to look like the lone gunman.
Yeah. And what is the national security value of an intelligence method that was used 59 years ago? Is there a compelling case to keep those methods secret right now in the context of a JFK story?
I without knowing the specific details, of course, I can't judge the agency's, you know, decision to release or not release. But I would say, again, philosophically, there are two arguments I think the agency has to be able to make to itself and to the Biden administration to justify what it's done. Number one is not just that there are methods, and I find it hard to believe. I don't know any method from 60 years ago, a single thing that I would argue should remain secret that I can think of, but there might be something. But then the second reason is the more compelling reason to release, I think. We routinely, as an agency, as a government, declassify and release information that does betray sources and methods if the other interests are compelling enough. And in this case, as I've tried to argue, the need for us to know the full truth outweighs even any argument the agency can make that it would be damaging to some source or method that's still in use today or was in use back then. Again, a very hard argument to make at the outset that's compounded by the fact that I don't see how you can make it when our own government has established that there probably was a rogue conspiracy to kill the president. Then how can you say that this kind of information would not be relevant to understanding if that's the case or not?
That's the presentation, and we're going to end with Fernand Amandi is going to talk about a poll that his firm, Ben Dixon Amandi International, did of midterm voters, and he asked them questions about the JFK issue, and I think his findings are really interesting. So, Ferdinand?
Thank you, Jeff. A little bit speechless after what I heard, paradigm shifting thing to hear that perhaps there was a CIA operation involving Lee Harvey Oswald prior to the assassination. I think it calls into question much of the scholarship and now the new history potentially if and when these files are released. Although Jeff said, I am here to talk about the role of public opinion and the role that public opinion plays in this story back all the way to the night of the assassination, all the way to the present day, because public opinion and the voice of the American people on this topic, and I can think of no more important a topic, the murder of a president of the United States within the borders of the country, public opinion has played a consistent role for almost 60 years, and I'm here to talk about the latest public opinion study on this question. So first off, the methodology. We wanted to do an authoritative study of 2,000 completed interviews that would be representative of the adult American electorate currently residing in the United States 59 years after the fact. We were actually in the field beginning November 14th, and our final night in the field was 59 years to the very day that another pollster, a gentleman by the name of George Gallup, first asked the American people on the night of November 22nd, 1963, do you believe the reports that one man was responsible for the shooting of President Kennedy, or do you think that others were involved in planning that assassination? The margin of error is plus or minus 2.2 percentage points for all of the top line findings. And as I mentioned, that particular question that George Gallup asked hours after the president was murdered that evening of November 22nd, 1963, is an important question because it's the very same question that we ask in this poll in order to have a longitudinal study to be able to compare apples to apples over the years, over the decades, what the answer to that question from the American people is. And the question is as follows. Do you think that one man, Lee Harvey Oswald, was responsible for the assassination of President John F. Kennedy? Or do you think that others were involved in a conspiracy? When George Gallup asked that question for the first time on November 22, 1963, 5 days later, he completed his poll results, and the results revealed as follows. 52% of Americans, a majority at that time, said they did not believe that Lee Harvey Oswald, one man, was responsible for the shooting. 53% felt that others were involved in a conspiracy. And that number slightly dipped and reached a historic low for the first time after the publication of the Warren Commission findings in September of 1964, where 50% of Americans at that point still felt others were involved, but 36% had agreed that Oswald acted alone in response to the Warren Commission findings. But then something happened rather dramatic when it came to what the American people thought about this crime, the murder of an American president in the streets of the United States. Wide, clear majorities started to say that they rejected the findings of the Warren Commission, that they did not believe that it was one man, that instead it was a conspiracy involving others. And that number held between the 80 percentile range, fluctuating a little bit all throughout the early 70s, into the 1980s, into the 1990s, all the way up until 2002, on the brink of the 40th anniversary of the assassination, where it remained at 81% as this poll was done over time. But what we've started to see since then in the 21st century is those numbers dropping somewhat. As recently as 2011, it was down to 61% of Americans believing that it was a conspiracy, whereas 30% said it was Oswald acting alone. And with that as the predicate, I'm here to show you what the American public today, in the year 2022, 59 years after the assassination, says on this critical question, this consistent question that George Gallup first asked 59 years ago on the night the president was murdered. Our results show that today, a majority of Americans, a bare majority, 50%, still believe that others were involved in a conspiracy. But a high water mark, 38%, for the first time in the polling that I've seen, now believe Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone, with 12% not knowing or not having an answer. Now, while some might say it is true that the numbers in support for the Oswald story, the story that the Warren Commission says is what happened, the person that was solely responsible for the murder of an American president on the streets of the United States, I think one still needs to look at the fact that never once since the assassination transpired, not once has there ever been a majority of our fellow citizens, of our fellow Americans, agree with the conclusions of the United States government on that critical question. What we find to this day is this holds amongst generations. Every group, a plurality, believes others were involved in a conspiracy to this day, although the young 18 to 29, those younger voters, are those most likely to feel that it was Lee Harvey Oswald that was involved by himself and responsible for the assassination. You see amongst the partisan breaks, Democrats are split on the question, 42 saying there was a conspiracy, 42 saying Oswald acted alone, whereas Republicans and independents, slight majorities in both cases, agree that it was others involved in a conspiracy. Also, interestingly, there was a regional break here where in the western part of the United States, defined by those states west of Arizona, Nevada, California, Oregon, and Washington State, that was the group most likely to believe that there was a conspiracy, whereas those in the Northeast, that was actually a statistical tie, with 45% saying it was a conspiracy, 43% saying one man was responsible. But that wasn't the only question we asked. The follow-up question to those 50%, that 50% majority that has held for 59 years, who today do those 50% believe was responsible for planning of the assassination of President Kennedy? Was it the CIA? Was it the mafia? Was it the government of Cuba? Was it the government of the Soviet Union? Or was it someone else? Well, of those 50%, these are the results who they believe was responsible for planning the conspiracy. 31%, the most cited group, was the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency. followed by the mafia at 13%. 7% felt it was the government of Cuba, the Castro government. 6% felt it was the communist government of the Soviet Union. 4% someone else. The largest segment was just unsure. 39% did not answer. And here again, every group across the age ranges, the one that was most cited was the CIA, followed by the mafia. We also see that in terms of party, the CIA was the group Democrats, Republicans, and independents cited as being most likely to have been responsible for the conspiracy to assassinate President John F. Kennedy. Which leads us now to the present. As much as this crime, this stain against our history, a lot of folks would like to relegate it to the past, the reason we are here assembled today, all of us, and those of you watching on the live stream and around the world, is because this question continues to echo through the decades. It echoes through the decades because as of this day, as our esteemed panel has shown, there is still not full transparency on this question, on the government's files about what happened to an American president. The government's files which say that president was killed by one man acting alone. Yet those files are still to this day somewhat repressed, somewhat not been fully disclosure. And that's the decision that the current American president in our year 2022 will be making in just over a week's time. So we ask that question when it comes to what will President Biden do? Will he follow through on his decision to release the files as he said last year he would on December 15th of this year, or at the request of the FBI and the CIA and other agencies, will he continue to withhold some of those files? So this is the question we put to the American people with the proper context to give them the backstory. Under a law the United States Congress unanimously passed in 1992, all JFK assassination files held by the federal government were supposed to have been fully released in October of 2017. But then President Donald Trump delayed their release until October 2021, when President Joe Biden delayed the release again until December 15th of this year at the request of the CIA and FBI under the grounds that releasing the remaining files represented identifiable harm to the national interest. Releasing the remaining files represented identifiable harm to the national interest. Those aren't my words. Those are the words of the Biden administration in their decision to call for the delay of what should have been a full release in 2021. The remaining files represented identifiable harm to the national interest. So the question we put to the American people is, do you think President Biden should release all of the withheld JFK assassination files on December 15th of this year, as his order stated, or do you think President Biden should postpone their release if the CIA, FBI, or other agencies ask him to do so again, as they did in 2021, because the remaining files represented identifiable harm to the national interest? 59 years later, after one man who the CIA and the FBI and the United States government in 1964 said, one man acting alone was responsible for the murder of an American president on the streets of the United States in broad daylight before the American people. Well, the American people now say to the tune of 71% that President Biden should not make haste. He should follow through on his order and release all of the withheld JFK assassination files. An astounding number. Only 10% think President Biden should continue postponing release of the assassination files. 19% were unsure, did not have an opinion. Now, in America in the year 2022, there is not much that unites the American people. I think one of the things that we agree is the times we find ourselves in, there is great polarization on issues and issues of controversy, of great controversy. This is not one of them. If you look at it by age, every single age group, overwhelmingly, 84% of those 18 to 29, 71% of those 30 to 49, 63% of those 50 to 64, and 75% of those 65 years or older, those who are most likely to have been alive and remember the assassination, are calling for President Biden to release the files, all of them, every single one of them, without haste, as his order promised last year. Are there any issues in the United States today which unites Democrats and Republicans and independents? There's really not many, but there is one. It's this one. Also here, 66% of Democrats, 76% of Republicans, and 69% of independents also would like to see President Biden release all of the files and not withhold any of their delay, despite whatever the intelligence agencies and any other federal agency might ask him to keep and delay. And here also we see this holds among ethnic boundaries. Every major ethnic group in the United States, whites, Hispanics, blacks, Asian Americans, and others, all overwhelmingly, nearly three quarters, would like to see President Biden make good on his pledge to release those files on or before December the 15th of this year, 2022. The final slide I'm going to show you is, even on this very pregnant issue of the assassination, where there are two points of view, that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone and was responsible for the murder of John F. Kennedy, as the Warren Commission stated, or those that differ, like you've heard some on the panel say today, that it was a conspiracy, perhaps engaged in by others. Even amongst the division on that question, those two camps are also united in wanting to see President Biden release these files. 71% of those that believe in a conspiracy want to see the files released, all of them without haste, on or before December 15th. 73% of those that believe Oswald acted alone also want to see the files. So at least from the perspective of the American people, there is consensus. There is not unanimity, but there is close to unanimity in our opinion. And now President Biden has a decision to make, with the American people having spoken very clearly, and I believe very eloquently, on this question, to release all of the files and once and for all allow the American people to study the government's records on what happened on November 22nd, 1963. Thank you.
Okay. That's the end of our presentation. I just want to say that I often am asked by young people, even people my age, what's the relevance, why are you still interested in the Kennedy assassination? And the answer is, this is the poster child for the problem of overclassification in our country. If we can't declassify 60-year-old records, how are we going to then declassify records that are happening now? The second thing is that the Secret Service destroyed records after the JFK Records Act went into effect. You know, the Secret Service destroyed records recently about January 6th. Nobody was punished in 1995 when they destroyed those records, and no one's punished now. They learn they get away with this stuff. And so this is why this is relevant for today. Jeff, we have a question from one of the streamers for you. It says, does David Atlee Phillips in any figure in any way in the Oswald operation? I have recently spoken to someone who knew him, who suggested to me that attempts to pin him in particular to the assassination were the result of KGB disinformation to get rid of nuisance agents. This person cited KGB officer Oleg Tassarev in support.
Does this microphone work? Is it coming through?
Yeah.
The information about David Atlee Phillips from a KGB officer has never come to my attention and is not a factor in my analysis of the case at all. David Atlee Phillips was the case officer who helped create and fund the DRE AMSPEL operation, and there is credible, uncorroborated report that Phillips was seen in Oswald's company in Dallas in 1963. Phillips is certainly somebody who might have known about the undisclosed Oswald operation as a one of the highest ranking CIA officers. And David Atlee Phillips was one of those officers who was familiar with Oswald's travel, his politics, his personal life, and his contacts with foreign officers while JFK was still alive. So he's an important character in the story. What exact role he played, we don't know because we don't have the documents.
Judge Sunheim, how would you characterize the candor of the agencies that the ARB encountered during its work?
Well, it's difficult to fully assess. I mean, we had good cooperation generally, I say, from particularly the CIA and the FBI, where most of the still classified records were held. You know, we did our best to try to build up an expertise to be able to see through when they weren't telling us the full truth. And still, we had a very limited time period in which we could operate. And agencies knew that they could outlast us if they stonewalled to a certain extent. So I would say general cooperation, fights over some major issues. We were fortunate because President Clinton supported us throughout, and there was a clear message throughout the administration. But there were deceptions. The Joannides matter was a major deception to us and earlier to the House Select Committee on Assassinations. And, you know, we had a special search for Angleton files, and the answer to any request for files that were in the possession of Angleton was that those files are no longer maintained as a collection, which means there wasn't anything. Now, I will say that in some cases, when we discovered records that had been destroyed at some point in time, we were able to recreate the records in the files of other agencies. And that was a great value to us, to kind of have that second or third agency that had copies of files that we could release. But overall, I found the CIA filing system to be very haphazard and chaotic. The FBI filing system was nearly perfect. I think the FBI never felt that anyone was going to be looking into these files at a later time. And speaking of organized crime, we released the files on all the major organized crime figures of the time, Sam Giancano. They were all released without any redactions made to them. So in answer to your question, I'd say overall good cooperation, people trying to help us to find records, but some major deceptions and probably some delays resulting in files staying at agencies until after we were no longer in office.
Any questions from any of the audience here? All right. Carl?
Do we need to use a microphone to...
I don't think we have a wireless mic, so we can repeat. Come up here.
Stand to the side here?
Yeah, sure.
Hi, Carl Golovin. Thank you to all the panelists for all you're doing to cause the records to be released. And Jefferson Morley, I wasn't put up to this by Jefferson, but his book, The Ghost, and several other books he's written on Amazon are highly worthy of acquiring. The Ghost, concerning James Angleton. I have one specific question for Judge Tunheim concerning the Northwoods document. Some have speculated it might be a fabrication. In relation to that, is there any proof that John Kennedy actually ever dealt with that specific document, or do we just presume that he denied it because, you know, the events never occurred? But in a broader context, I would ask, sometimes one doesn't see the forest but for the trees. The documents being the trees, we're very focused on release of the documents. But in a larger geopolitical context, we always think of Vietnam and for example, the CIA as a whole as involved in the assassination. But we forget that the major changes in policy from Kennedy to LBJ all involved the Middle East. Kennedy was desperately working to keep Israel from getting nuclear weapons. He had ordered, based on Senate Foreign Relations Committee advice, he'd ordered the then existing Israeli lobby to register as foreign agents. He was insisting that the 800,000 displaced Palestinians be allowed to return to their homes. Jack Ruby.
Is there a question?
What's the question, Carl?
Well, do we overlook? Jack Ruby said to his attorney, William Kunzler, that he killed Oswald to prevent a pogrom of American Jews over the assassination. Do we overlook the biggest change in history in the last 100 years is the reestablishment of the State of Israel? And was not Israel the primary beneficiary of the assassination as of 9/11? And are we afraid to look at this because of concerns of, quote, anti-Semitism?
I'm not afraid.
Okay.
I'm not afraid.
I'd recommend The Unspoken Kennedy Truth by Laura Guillenot as a book.
Judge Tunheim, could you answer the question about the discovery of the Operation Northwoods papers? I think that's an interesting story. That was maybe the most significant revelation.
You know, I can't give you any real details about that. We were just hunting and searching and trying to find everything that we possibly could. If someone said that a particular area was possibly related to the assassination, for example, Vietnam policy, we sought those records and tried to make a determination that, you know, we're not going to make conclusions about all this. We're just going to find the records, find them wherever we can. If there was any suggestion anywhere that there was a connection, we would release the records so that the American public could decide for themselves. And Northwoods came up in that, and maybe you can give some more detail, Jeff, because I think you've been looking much more into it.
Well, I think Rex pointed something important out about the Northwoods documents, which was that only one copy was found in the Secretary of Army's possession. But there must have been many other components of the Pentagon who participated in the planning. The J-2 staff was involved in the planning. So why was there only one copy that was found? What happened to the other Northwoods copies? I mean, I don't think we know, but I think that it was only by the thorough work of the review board that we even found that one copy, and it might not have ever come to light without the review board.
Jeff, the 44 Joannides documents, are they part of the collection or some outside the collection?
Well, the CIA has taken different positions. A lot of the Joannides material is in the collection, thanks to the review board. When the review board asked about Joannides, the CIA first responded deceptively and disavowed any knowledge of his actions in 1963, said he didn't have contact with the DRE AMSPEL group in that time, which was false. The review board then went in with Michelle Combs, was a senior researcher who had actually worked in the CIA and knew the record-keeping systems, and it was Michelle Combs who found the Joannides files, and about 10 pages of that file were released by the review board in November 1998, a couple months after the board went out of existence. When we realized the significance of those documents and showed them to Bob Blakey and Dan Hardway, you know, the obvious question was, well, you know, what about the rest of what he was doing in 1963? There was no review board anymore, and so there was no way to obtain the rest of these records. As Judge Tunheim has said, they're obviously assassination-related, and the CIA should have provided them, but some parts of the Joannides material have not yet been put into the JFK collection.
So in theory, then, those records that are not in the collection are not subject to President Biden's order.
Well, they're subject to the JFK Records Act, which says that even after the review board expires, agencies have the obligation, when they discover new JFK records, to put them into the collection. Right. So they are not yet in the collection, but they clearly belong in the collection, and it's our view that they absolutely belong in the collection.
So that raises the question, if we don't have a complete release next week, Judge Tunheim, do we need a new ARB? Do we need to have legislation passed to help give more power to NARA? What do you think? Or do you have an opinion?
Well, I think enough authority is there right now, and I've argued this throughout the years, that the National Archives has the authority to follow up on the work of the review board. You know, most of those years they haven't been willing to do that. I think it's been much more aggressive lately, partly due to presidential orders to create a complete collection at the National Archives. You know, if there's still materials, relevant materials that aren't released after the 15th, then I think Congress should take a look at this to see whether there's something more that needs to be done to get everything out.
Okay. Any other questions in the audience? Chad, you want to? I can repeat the question if it's short.
Yeah, I'll try to speak up. Dallas at the time of the assassination. And many years after both of them died, Clay Shaw and J. Jim Garrison, the New Orleans district attorney who prosecuted him. Many years after they died, it was revealed that, in fact, the defendant had been on the domestic contact service list of the CIA for a particular period. So whether or not he was involved in the assassination or the conspiracy aside, he might have committed perjury. I don't know how the domestic contact service works, but perhaps there was the head of the domestic contact service in New Orleans, whose name is obscure. Are the files relating to him in any way relevant, as they are for J. Walton Moore?
The question is about J. Walton Moore and a contact services.
The domestic contact service and
domestic contact service in New Orleans.
And how relevant that was in New Orleans.
And how relevant, yeah.
So a couple of things are worth saying. James Walton Moore was the head of the CIA in Dallas in 1963. His personnel file is in the collection, a couple hundred pages with extensive redactions in it. That's one of the cases that we call attention to because Moore is one of the many CIA officers who was well acquainted with Oswald before the assassination. In fact, it was Moore who recommended Oswald to George de Morenschild, a Dallas geologist who spoke Russian. And Moore arranged for the introduction for Oswald to meet de Morenschild in 1962 and 1963, and they became close friends. So I'm not sure that Moore's personnel file, while heavily redacted, has information directly relevant to the assassination. But I think that it does have information that's relevant to how he did his job for the CIA in Dallas in 1963, and that is definitely assassination related. So we believe that the redactions in the Moore personnel file, of which there are many, several hundred in several hundred pages of documents, that should be fully released as well.
We have one last question, which is a doozy, which probably no one can answer. What did Nosinko know?
I don't have anything to add to that.
Okay. Andrew.
One last question.
One last question, okay.
Andrew Craig from Kappa, I'm also a reporter, and maybe this is directed to the Mary Ferrell Foundation leader. Currently, there's an effort by the Dallas Morning News and perhaps other civic leaders to create a mall transforming the scene of the assassination in Dallas. And this would remove, as I understand it, the grassy knoll, the picket fence. Do you see any relationship between that kind of change of the assassination scene and documentary history that this lawsuit and focus relates to?
So the question is there was an article in the Dallas Morning News about a proposal to redevelop Dealey Plaza, and that the redevelopment would essentially eliminate the grassy knoll. And you're asking if there's any significance with that plan and the release of records. And
do I have to do something with the mic?
No, we can hear you.
Okay. So I've been recently made aware of this. The Mary Ferrell Foundation per se has not, you know, weighed in on this. You know, we have other stuff we're paying attention to. I will say my personal view is that Dealey Plaza should be a National Historic Site and preserved for all the obvious reasons, including the ability for future technologies to study it in more detail, for people to do 3D reconstructions, whatever reasons for reanalyzing the acoustics evidence. There's a lot of potential reasons, and so that'd be my personal view, certainly.
Yeah. And it's really just a proposal at this point, and like anything else, it'd have to go through public hearing. Doesn't mean that the current proposal as stands is going to be the proposal that ends up. There, you have environmental reviews, you have all kinds of reviews, so, and then there's obviously legal challenges. So whether this actually happens, we don't know, but that was news that was learned last week. So with that, I want to thank the speakers for their participation. Obviously, people can watch this on YouTube later on, and I just want to thank the National Press Club for hosting this, for Mary Farrell for sponsoring this, and also for Ben Dixon and Amandi as well for their financial contribution as well. So with that, we'll call it a day. Thank you.
Thank you.